Brighouse. Back in our minutes. Under item one, it's members' code of conduct and declaration of interest. Are there any further declarations other than the ones which will be regularly registered? Anyone? Good. Apologies, I have them from Jim Crabtree. Anybody else? Apologies?
Pat Williams,
right, thank you. Any others? Minutes, can I sign the minutes as a correct record? Thank you. Now, are there matters of arising that do not come up in the agenda? I have noticed none. What I want to do, given that we will be in chorus at 4:15, what I have done is take from the body of the meeting the six topics which are within that agenda, and of which I would very much like the meeting to concentrate on and to make decisions. First is the best use of the antisocial behaviour budget. It's in the minutes there. Secondly, the best use of the budget to keep Birkenhead clean. Thirdly, your investment in feeding Birkenhead. Fourthly, we've got a report back from Bev of Home Start on the breastfeeding project. Five, a report back on Crossways. And six, a report back on the school readiness intervention at a very little school, St Paul's Community Hub. So might I move the agenda around those so that this meeting makes six lots of decisions. The first is about the antisocial behaviour budget. There is this new agenda which I think people think, is that right, Jeff? So has everyone got it? Because it just lists the main issues taken from the papers, thank you for Andrew over there, of where we need to actually move to. The first thing is we've had two bids under our social behaviour budget. And might we follow our normal procedure, which is to refer those bids to the task and finish group, which decides these issues and then recommends to us. Is that agreed? The second thing is, Joe, and you can come in and correct me if I'm wrong, but we had a report and we commissioned Tony Kinsella to break down the data in the borough on antisocial behaviour, looking at those areas where most problems were reported. And there were three in all, if I can remind you. One was in the park, one was around Asda, and one was around McDonald's. And we had a budget for 54k as a constituency committee to spend. And we, at our last meeting, decided a number of grants which has reduced that sum to £31,500. And therefore, one of the things that we need to decide here is how do councillors wish that budget to be spent. Given the analysis that Tony produced for us, was there's three particular areas, they may be changing, I grant you that. And also we made a decision at the meeting before that, that what we would try and do with these additional monies would be to add value rather than just merely pay money to existing services. And at that meeting, two meetings ago, this meeting decided that it would like this to be councillor and community led, i.e. that we would be looking in particular areas and asking councillors to be even more active in the areas than they are and get ideas from local residents and what they would like to see happen with our budget over and above all the other services the council and the police try and provide here. And I just wonder, given that we've got park, which is in, your ward,
Birkenhead Park,
debate. McDonald's were very clear, weren't they, about how they might wish to respond. There was real problems in Shore Street, Phil. We've not had so there's no reason why I should have done. But do you think there are possibilities of the councillors in Birkenhead talking to both McDonald's and Asda, and because Shore Street was played, hopefully no more, but it may well be, if we made an allocation of additional monies, what would they like it to be spent on?
I think in the case of Shore Street, as a result of the antisocial behaviour there, we had a CCTV camera fitted and a fence fitted at the end so people can't cut through to Borough Road. So I think there's been a significant drop in ASP in Shore Street as a result of those measures. So I think in terms of the best use of the money, I think Shore Street's probably okay for the moment, but we need to keep an eye on.
Chris, I saw your email trail looking at whether all our CCTV cameras in the boroughs were. Might you report to the meeting?
What we did was, we had a few incidents in North Ferry, and I asked if the cameras were being watched properly, because if they're not here now, are they, George? They've been moved into the little, the viewing of the cameras, and that they're not watched from our control room anymore. I was really concerned. We had a few incidents in Rock Ferry where we had the pensioners' bungalows down in Peterfield. All the pensioners have been bombed down there. I was just really, really concerned. And I think what did it for me was when the Swiss Bridge got there down at Brighton Park, the cameras weren't working there. So it just concerns me that I think there's a lot of people out there who think because the cameras aren't working. But I've had an email back to say that they have spent some money on some of the all of them, so it just concerns me. I mean, the Swiss Bridge really broke our hearts in Birkenhead Park. As you know, that comes under my portfolio, and there was no way they could get any images of the people who'd done it. So, what I would like is to see more CCTV in Birkenhead Park. And I know through the park school, which George is on with me, we had asked to get some more cameras in there. So,
I support Chris 100% on that, but I mean, what I would say, Frank, is that. The actual monitoring of the cameras is now done by the police. It's done in Honourwood, still in Manor, it's done from there.
That's not what I was told, George.
Okay, that's fine. Mm.
I was told it's done over in Liverpool now.
No, it hasn't gone there. As far as I'm aware, it hasn't gone there yet, because no one's gone there. It's supposed to be our road in
well, I was told it's over there.
Could you think on that? Yeah. So we go along. Could we agree, Joe? You will find out what the position is and post it on our constituency website so everybody, as well as our councils and MP, can actually find out what the answer is.
Okay.
All
position right? On CCTV. Yes. Thanks.
Do you think you might also find out, Joe, for us, what percentage of the cameras are actually working?
Yeah.
Secondly, yes.
Frank, I was going to say that we've had a request from Canton Primary School where they've had break-ins where the computer equipment has been taken, and they have got kind of CCTV in there, but nobody's monitoring it and watching it. So I know one of the things that they'd requested was kind of whether their cameras can be linked up to somewhere, you know, where they are getting monitored.
And yeah, did the school put the cameras in themselves?
Yeah.
Right.
Yes, they did.
If the answer to that is quite simple. If they are a member of community patrol safeguard their school, the information from that CCTV should be fed to them. So it's like the old school, I can see down cameras any day of the week on the campus, and it's all there. And I do see community patrol every single night at 4 to 7 going to the school.
But do schools have to use their budgets? to opt in to community control?
Yes.
Was it done automatically?
No. Right.
Do you think we might, Joe, then, as a constituency committee, have a note from you, a list of all the schools which are opted into community control, which have CCTV cameras?
Yeah, but the cameras aren't, the monitors aren't in there, they're actually monitored.
No, sure.
Yes.
They
don't watch them directly.
Are they linked in? If
schools don't link in.
If
it was anything happened, community control would come up, take the evidence off school's CCTV.
No, they used to be linked in,
that
was the control room, George.
Well, I mean, the thing is, if you're a parent and you pay for your school to have CCTV cameras, you'd actually want somebody to be monitoring.
Of course you would.
So my guess is, we could try and find out what would be the cost of those schools that haven't to opt in to pay the police to monitor, or, which is a more obvious thing, community control. It would be quite good, and then we can go back to the schools, can't we?
Yeah.
And then the second one is, if it is the service going over to Liverpool, is it manned 24 hours a day, the reading of
that book?
Is what we want to use.
That book.
We do have a task group. It, would it be possible to get, say, a representative from community control and with the void of the expert police officers
absolutely
in the room?
I've welcome.
So it's a little bit of a sterile debate going around without the experts
absolutely
there. So my view would be that if we're looking to invest in CCTV, then we want to know that's the right way to go. I remember when we had some money to spend locally, one of the things we did, we were having trouble in Flavour Cemetery and Hoy Lake Road, remember George? And basically we used our chunk of money just at the key times to have a physical presence. We paid directly to police for a community support officer to actually patrol at a particular time. I'm not saying that's the be all and end all, but we talked to the gentleman before the meeting because we are about to announce major cuts in community support officers. However, if CCTV is being deemed as the cure-all and it isn't, then we're going down a very wrong path. So I would suggest that we take on board the suggestions that are being made, find out where it's being monitored and how we could improve that system, and possibly some physical presence at key times that is taking place. And with the money that we have left, see how we can best use it. Is that right?
So we agree that report initially will be made to the task and finish group, and then we'll make recommendations how we might spend our 30k plus effectively.
Can I just add one point? Because I think that's in some ways a negative, but a good positive is that, and you were actually heavily involved Frank, in October, there was a race haze, which is down there, but the anti-social behaviour task force and the team all came together, and five of our partners all come together and all put £2,000 each into. And the Liverpool Football Club, they now meet every Thursday night on October at Ridgeway High School. And it's a distraction. There's now 27 kids every single Thursday night are waking up there with the Liverpool Football Club and the Fire Brigade. And it's an absolutely first class thing. And that fund that was given 1 year, but it sounds like
there's an opportunity to expand that in the zone mandates, working with them in other areas or hotspot areas, so we can report that back to that group as well.
But when we are going to the task force, I mean, Tony did say, and the data that he had, it was the park, it was Chris's Rose, Asda and McDonald's. Joe, might you ask Asda and McDonald's before that task and finish group meets what ideas they have as well and what the problems are? So that you actually have all of that. Is there anything else people want to add? Yes,
Frank, as I spoke to Steve before, I've been led to believe, and it's more than led to believe, I've been told that the community support officers, of which 375 are going to be made redundant very, very shortly, and of course the 20 mounted policemen also going to be made redundant, the CID and its civilian support are going to be civilianised and put out to contract. Your ideas are very good, but we really need some other method of actually funding these community support offices which are going. And it would be nice, really, if the likes of Asda and the shops around that area would not even thought about funding a community support officer out their own budgets, because most would be taxed. We get they get a tax lift on that anyway. It's a way round this possibility of, well, not possibility, the actual fact that we're going to lose so many community support officers, and they've put the police under severe pressure. Anyway, get me.
No, sure. when you're talking to Asda and McDonald's, might you raise that possibility with them? And I also think they're facing housing issues.
It's the way round, Frank. With money shortage, to go out to these businesses, like in the Durley, to see if they will fund a community support officers locally.
I'm not in favour of that. What I'm saying is that businesses have got a big, quite a big bill to finance living wages. We're going to ask them to support. I'm all in favour of asking them, but I wouldn't put all our eggs in that basket. But it is important to note that the Charter Can Finish group, we only have £31,500 to make a difference.
Yeah.
It's how do we use that money strategically to get best effect. Is that all right? Fine. Okay. Thanks very much. Yes, Alan.
It is important. We do have these discussions, and at times it looks as though we're not really making a huge amount of progress. I would like, if we're going to have a Cllr Can Finish group, I would like to have a very strict deadline put on it, because there's a fear of it, there's a bit of drift that might take place.
Right. What's a reasonable time scale then, please?
A fortnight
or 3 weeks, what do you think?
End of the month.
All right. Very good. To report back. I mean, Andrew from my office in London is here with us today. Takes an interest in the whole of this area, and reprioritise the agenda for us. Andrew is actually going to keep a note of all the action points, so that on Monday there will be a set of action points, who's doing what, when, where. Because, you know, it's wonderful to have these minutes and all the rest of it, but I sometimes feel it would be quicker to get a solution in Syria than to get changing the timetable when the minutes could actually circulate. So we actually will have on Monday, we will actually have all of us a note from Andrew saying who's doing what. So one of those things about the Cllr Can Finish and about the end of the month. And I think, Andrew, we've got points about the beginning of the agenda for that group and the sign-off day. Great. All right. Then the best use of the budget, keep Birkenhead clean. Again, at the last meeting, we decided let's not have another local newspaper, but to put the money, if I remember rightly, Joe, into keeping Birkenhead clean. So might you tell us what's in the budget and what will be added by not producing a newspaper, which might add to the amount of rubbish we've got. Maura, do you want to say?
No, I think Joe's probably best placed to talk about the budget side, but I would like to talk about some of the work we did when the Environmental Task Group met. I don't know, do you want to go first, Joe?
Yeah, we had £20,000 to go into environmental projects, and that was made up of £13,000, which was allocated to third-size communities together to expand the Grot Spot project, and then £14,000 to LCT and £6,000 for skip funds, so that was £1,000 per ward to border skips. And of the £14,000, it was an expansion of the Grot Spots 1 project, which was clearing up historically areas of land which had a lot of fly tipping and debris, and they were privately owned. So they were highlighted by the councillors, and then LCT assessed each Grot Spot area and worked an action plan how they would deal with them over the course of the year. And they've actually put a monitoring report in the pack. Moira's going to talk about that in a bit more detail.
Right, so how much money have we got now in total to spend in this coming year, given there's that budget, plus we're not spending money on a newsletter?
We've got £14,000 for LCT and the £6,000 for the skip fund
haven't seen these points. Thanks, Joe. I haven't seen these points that are down on this amended agenda. But I would like to address some of the points that raised. First of all, I haven't seen this email before, but I'm very grateful that Mr. Robinson is asking to meet with us to look at some of the concerns, particularly about action taken on land that's in private ownership that's in poor condition, and the difficulties of clearing that land quickly and recharging the owners of the land. Because I know that officers do put forward reasons why that is slow. We did look at the lift contract and we looked at how well it works, particularly in street cleaning, where there seems to be an inflexibility about the use of equipment. And I know that there's been concerns about the frequency of street cleaning, but specifically about the equipment use and how it deals with problems in roads where there's a lot of parking and people can't get in there. So we've asked for a breakdown of the spend on the BIFA contract, and we hope we'll get that for the next time we meet, which I think is in a week or so. It was productive because we had Mike Clark from LCT there who was able to talk us through the Grot Spots project and identify what has been done in the different areas. And I hope that you can, as I can in Rock Ferry, now see an improvement in those areas. What we're looking to do now is to extend that to a phase two. And what I'm asking the ward councillors to do is to get together and between yourselves identify the five worst areas in your ward and let me have those areas by the end of the month. If you want to see some of the work that LCT have been doing, I think they're very happy to take you around and show you. But I have been impressed by that. As I say, we are interested in the BIFA contract and how that's working, but we haven't got the information we need on that yet, and hopefully we will. The SCIP project has been underused. In fact, it's only been used in Rock Ferry Ward twice. But can I remind ward councillors, you've got £1,000 there. If your communities are wanting to do a community clean-up, there is the money there to provide SCIPs for you to use for that. Mike was also telling us about some of the work that LCT are doing to support, supplement, whatever word you want to use, the BIFA contract in cleaning alleyways, cleaning roads, cleaning areas like Portland Village. I would have thought that should have come under the BIFA contract, but there you go. We'll find out why that isn't when we have a look at the spend. And the other thing that we want to promote is the In Bloom project, which is World Horticultural Society. I have trouble with that word. Horticultural Society, there's one beautiful example, is it in Jamesbrook, in Binston, where the community have cleared up a back entry and turned it in from a horrific site to the most lovely little area for the community to use. Very little expenditure. We've identified areas across Birkenhead that we can do that in. Portland Village, I know, is one. We've got the area around the one-stop shop in Rock Ferry, and there's areas around Sainsbury's, I think, in Prenton Oxford Village has been identified. But very small expenditure, and it can make a big difference on it, certainly for communities. And that's about it on that one. But the specific questions here, I'll take those back to the next meeting and we'll get those answers and feedback to you for next time, either written or verbal.
Maura, what's the timetable? Because I mean, Alan's point, when will you be meeting again?
I've forgotten the date. I think it's, we met on 23rd of September, I think it's somewhere towards the end of October. So we'll have it for the next meeting.
So at the end of this month again, we'll be meeting.
Yeah.
Right. Do you think you could actually take Eric's letter?
Yes.
Because one of the key things, he says that the BIFA contract is being monitored. And I just wonder if you could tell
us how the monitoring
is done. The
contract monitoring is all done through contract monitoring department. It's, we've had the same discussion in other areas where contracts are now being used, particularly around adult social care, and how quality features in those contracts, and clearly I think there is an issue about quality on the contracts, not just the frequency of the cleaning, but actually the quality of the cleaning as well. That's what we'll be looking at very closely.
Right. And you're from the trust, aren't you, doing cleaning up, is that right? Maura, look towards you.
Yes.
Would you like to say something for us, feed into our discussion?
I think we have got the contract for layers like communities together, and I think I just want to pick up what Joe said. There was a £14,000 allocation in the contract that finishes in December. So we've been doing this for just on a year now in the first Grot Spot contract. I don't think we can underestimate, and there is a report that Mike has produced, the amount of tonnage that has been removed from some of the sites that we've removed and we've cleared. And we are in contact with some private owners, which is in the report, I think it's what Moira was talking about before, what's going on the line. And for us, it's about more about the clearance and the continued engagements as well around some of those areas so that they don't become the same eyesores that they've been in the past, and how can we keep that and continue to back?
Say, I didn't mention that, and this is where we get back to the confusion about over who does what. Street scene and proportion of flag tipping, and they do deal with that, albeit rather slowly. You're backing up the work that they do by a quick response, and I saw evidence of that yesterday when I reported something on Monday, I think it was, and it was cleared away yesterday. The street scene response is very slow, and I'm wondering why we're paying too lots of service, but we'll get into that.
Eric says he wants to sort those out, so that would be good.
Nice.
Might we just ask you, when the site is privately owned, as Ken here from the Leeward Bank, what are the problems?
The key problem is often actually being able to contact that private landowner, in all honesty.
Right.
Or where we have those details and work alongside council officers to find the details, we always write to the landowners, but in all honesty, if they choose not to engage with us, that is obviously their right, but there are a lot of the sites that we've worked on that we have gone in and cleared.
Even though it's private? And what happens with the billing, please?
The billing, we continue to work and try and engage with the landowner about. And that's been an ongoing process. I joined Involved Northwestern, have acted in the team manager role within Lairdside Communities Together since around February, March time, really. So in my experience of leading colleagues on this particular contract, it's been a process of again and again trying to engage with the landowners. But if there was a feeling, obviously, that we would respond to from the constituency committee that we need to up the pressure or, if you understand my words, upon those landowners in terms of we can simply invoice them. And if, you know, if that's the, obviously, you know, we will openly, you know, work to the constituency.
That's what we've
okay.
Can you tell us, as we all should, despite being given, I think we should remain within the law.
Yes.
We've got a site. There was a site near where I live in Rock Ferry for years done. And it took, you know, superhuman effort between the councillors and me to get it cleared, which seems to me something pathetic about that itself. Now, supposing on day one we'd reported to the trust, we'd like this site cleared.
Yes.
What legal requirement does the landlord have to our, I mean, well, move one, presumably the land registry tells us who owns it.
Well, that's correct. The search can be made to the land registry to clarify the details in relation to who owns that particular piece of land. However, that only relates to land that is registered. And it could be quite a large number of parcels of land in the Wirral that haven't been exchanged for a number of years and therefore remain what they call unregistered. And those are the difficult areas in relation to clarification of ownership that the local authority would have to ascertain who are the particular owners of that, those pieces of property. If the land registry is able to give us details in relation to ownership, then we can enter into discussions, we can serve notices, we can, if notices aren't complied with in the legislation, actually prosecute or seek to clean those areas of land and then recover monies in respect of that, or charge on the property. But in relation to areas where the land is not registered, that is a difficult.
Right. Yeah. Might you check the law, because I thought under the Labour government, all unregistered land was given a time limit and it had to register, because I know the cathedrals that had lots of their assets unregistered were in danger of losing the assets to current occupiers if they didn't actually register, and they did. So I thought the Act now required there was to be no unregistered land, and if there was, it raised questions about Yes. The task and finish group. But supposing we've got somebody who is unregistered and it's, you know, it's a health hazard, it's misery for residents. How long does the law give the unregistered landlord the opportunity to hide behind being unregistered before the land is cleared, a bill presented and a charge put on the property?
Well, I think it would be in those circumstances what we would have to do in relation to unregistered land is to serve notice by way of a sign on site to indicate to the owner, whoever that is, that, you know, this is there is an issue in relation to litter on the land, etc., and that we are serving the notice for them to clear it within a certain period of time. And if that period of time is not complied with, as set out in the site notice, we can then take action at least to go on and clear the area.
What does the law say is the minimum time you have to give them, Ken? Do you know?
Off the top of my head, I don't. I think you'd be looking at something in the region of about 14, 28 days.
Right, so it could be done quite quickly.
One of the things that's been contemplated in our minds is that there's almost two sets of services running along here. There's what the council do, and you're describing the, you know, the difficulties you've got in getting enforcement on private owners. And then we've got LCT who are prepared to go in and do it, and then charge, and then sort that bit out afterwards. And we're commissioning this as an extra. What we want to do when we get the BIFA spend is look at how much of the BIFA contract is being spent on the process that you've described there, mm-hmm. and compare that with the 14,000 that we're commissioning directly from LCT.
Can I make I think it's fairly important, going back to the issue about skips, we are at that time of the year when normally there's a campaign by Merseyside Fire Authority to get as much rubbish away before bonfire night. We are often plagued by small bonfires because there's lots of rubbish around. So can someone contact Merseyside Fire Authority and link up with them? And if they are running a campaign and need money to help get skips out, to get them off the streets before they start collecting bonfire stores, as I did when I was a kid, we would be sort of hitting the antisocial behaviour thing on the head, and at the same time be making best use of our money and getting stuff rubbish away. So if we can liaise with the fire authority, that would be really good.
It's done on a ward by ward basis, that's the only
yes.
thing I can say. So don't spend our money.
Okay, right. I'm not spending your money, but if example, George, we always have a big campaign on our tournament stadium because it's historically been one of the worst areas. If they need £1,000 to help their campaign because they'll be under cuts the same as everyone else, I'm more than happy to allow that to be part of it.
Could you, Joe, with Denise, you're on the fire authority, aren't you?
Yes.
Could you actually get the details Phil's Steve's asking for, and then to the task and finish group?
Yes.
Well before the end of the month. There's like community trust.
We have, in answer to Steve, we have in the past provided that service of pre and post bonfire night clear up. And we've gone back to the council and suggested we do it again this year.
Paul, when you tidied up that bottom area in Oxford, how much did it cost you to get a skip?
£150.
So we could get quite a lot of skips.
Well, we've been told 130 now, so we've brought twice now.
Well done.
30 or an extra £25 if you want it on the road. The views of town's not far from a number of occasions.
We talk about, I mean, I just, in a way, I'd like to know what the legal position is, because we do, at the moment, serve notice, do we not, on many pieces of land, and we put notices up and tell the owner to tidy it up, and very often little or no action is taken. I'm not sure that we ever ultimately go on to pursue the full legal route, partly out of cost. I think there are some instances, if we're not, again, breaking the law, where we perhaps just should go onto the land and clear it. If we then have an argument about who pays for it and we don't get any payment, so be it. But for the cost of clearing small pieces of land, I'm not talking about a large area of land, but there are some small pieces of land where, to be perfectly honest, I think we should be prepared to pay, go onto it, clear it. That would be a cheaper option than actually going down the full route of involving the legal team.
it might be a cheaper option in the short term, but if there is action against the council for trespass or any tortious action, then that could result. And that's just a warning, as Frank said, about being lawful. It's a risk if we don't go through the proper legislative process.
But if they ever did suggest trespass for children on the land, it won't be so true. They won't do it to them.
What I can say as well, that there is legislation, because there is legislation, and I myself have actually prosecuted a number of individuals in relation to being in breach of the notices, and this has resulted in quite hefty court fines.
Right. Yes, Paul?
Just a quick point then. I've just briefly mentioned to Alan, but as you go around Oxton, I mean, Oxton pretty much, is any Oxton residency, pretty much takes care of itself in lots of ways. Any rot spots tend to be small and on private land. We don't really have many issues on public land. I mean, if there was a distribution of cash, I'd rather see our allocation of cash go to the borders of Oxton, you know, Balls Road and other areas where we do have problems, which are a gateway into Oxton. So I don't think we should split the money equally across the wards. I think we should focus the money on where the real hot spots are.
All right. That's a good point, though. I'm happy with that. And well done, the Trust, getting the sites cleaned up. I'm sure the residents give you a cheer. All right, can I move on to feeding Bristol? You invested quite a bit of your money, spare money, in this project, and I wonder whether briefly Andy and Andrew worked on it might report back on how many hungry children would have been fed as a result. Andy first, then Andrew.
We probably got the same information
really
in terms of how the project's went and the number of children that were fed. It's just to say really that this constituency committee decided to use the allocation of your will money to focus on feeding Birkenhead campaign, and we funded a number of social sector groups to carry out projects over the school holidays. One of the advantages of doing it this way is that all organisations work differently. They all engage with different groups in their own area, and I noticed a few people here today who run projects, and it really allowed them to work with people in their nearby area, really, which not only did it allow them to engage with some of the young children in the area and feed them in the holidays, but I think it's allowed them to also build up that relationship with the young people and the families in the area, which will hopefully continue to grow in the future. So I think Andrew's got the figures up in terms of how many kids we've
Sorry for the summer, there were 7 projects running. 2,058 children across the town were fed at a cost of £3.51 per child. All 7 projects have said they intend to carry on into the October half term, which we're really pleased about. But there is uncertainty for Christmas and beyond. So the chair has written to 4 schools with the highest proportion of pupils as well as the free school meals to see whether they might open up their facilities during the school holidays. And even if our voluntary groups with Fair Share get the meals prepared off-site, but the kids are fed on-site and given sports and other activities to do. Maybe that could be a long-term thing, but I understand the chair might propose a follow-up action on that front.
The 4 schools we wrote to with the highest number of poorer children on preschool dinners was the Rock Ferry School, Christchurch, Holy Cross and Cathcart Street. None of the schools have replied. And I just wonder whether we might, from this meeting noted they didn't reply, and recopy the letter. We know schools are under lots of pressure, but there is a real big issue here about schools have a responsibility, and they know how important free school dinners are to lots of their most vulnerable children. And then come the holidays, they shut the doors. I know Emma, is Emma here? Emma, yeah. Might you say something about your project? Because it was one of the great successes.
Over summer we had some poor world funding, and we fed 897 children across the Birkenhead ward through using surplus food donations and food waste, but it was extreme amounts of food waste.
a brilliant part of the project, actually. And I think, Emma, aren't we meeting up in Rock Ferry on Saturday? We are. I mean, and I just wonder whether if it works in Rock Ferry, it might become as sort of feeding hubs in each of the wards where there was a demand. In that the Vikes, the youth club, is, you know, how it continues. And you ought to make a bid, won't you, about taking it over and using it as a food hub for after school activities and so on. And I just wonder whether, as these projects come up, whether the three councillors in the ward would themselves form a task and finish group so that they and Phil's leader, me and Andrew, are interested in these matters as well, might form groups in which we then report back to what we propose. But it's a huge opportunity because it's a great building and it's got a kitchen, which is quite important.
Yes.
And we're going to meet you, please. Activities do you initially have in mind that if we can get the Vike Centre for you and some money, what is it you want to do there?
I've got a short presentation.
We won't have, literally, we've only got half an hour, we've got that. Can you speak?
What it is, it's Leo Community Cafe and the Seed Project. It's a project that is a social